Namaste Ram, welcome to Ahimsa Conversations.
Namaste.
Thank you for making the time. So like with everyone else, let's start with the same question, which I ask everyone to begin with. What is your earliest memory of either the concept or the experience of nonviolence from your childhood?
So honestly, I can't say, Rajni, that I had any particular experience of nonviolence growing up. I mean, I grew up in a family which was influenced by the freedom struggle and Gandhi in a kind of general way. For example, there was an absolute lack of religious sectarianism in our home. Although technically I was born in a Brahmin household, I never wore a sacred thread, and my father never wore a sacred thread because he was opposed to this mark of distinction. And somewhere this must have come from growing up in the 30s and 40s under the shadow of Gandhi and Nehru, right? So, but I cannot say Ahimsa per se, except that I was a shy child. I didn't like getting into fights in school. If I did, I would get beaten up, you know, because I wasn't really, you know, hatta-katta type of chap. But otherwise, I wouldn't say that, Ahimsa was really part of my childhood.
Okay. But then when, as a historian, I mean, as a scholar, you have had an abiding interest in not just the historical, political, but the life of Mahatma Gandhi. Did nonviolence feature at all in the draw, or was it something else that gave you such a long-term interest in Gandhi?
So that's a very good question. I mean, I'll have to go back to when I started my research. So when I studied in Delhi, I grew up in Dehradun, and then went to university in Delhi, and then went to Kolkata to do a PhD. And when I started my PhD, very early on, I got interested in the Chipko movement. And of course, that became the subject of my doctoral dissertation in my first book, The History of Forests and Peasants in the Himalaya. And I traveled in the Himalaya. I met Chandi Prasad Bhatt, Sundarlal Bhaguna, Radha Bhatt, who's not as well known as the other two, but you would know her well, an exemplary social activist with a deep and abiding commitment to nonviolence.
She was one of the early Ahimsa conversations.
So when I saw them, I was very inspired by what they had learned from Gandhi secondhand, because none of them, they come from the generation after Gandhi. You know, unlike say Baba Amte and Thakur Das Bang, and Jayaprakash Narayan, who knew Gandhi, who had been in the ashram. These people are one generation later, but yet they imbibed that spirit. So I was deeply impressed by that. And I would do my field work, go back to Kolkata, where I was doing my research. And Kolkata, the early 1980s, was the intellectual atmosphere was suffused by, I would say, dominated by Marxism. And my Marxist teachers, my Marxist colleagues, found my research problematic on two counts. One, back in the early 80s, the Marxists disparaged the environmental movement. They said it's a bourgeois deviation from the class struggle. In the early 80s, now it's very different. 40 years later, the Marxists have awakened to the environmental predicament. But back then, they thought it was a bakwas, this is a wishy-washy, elitist stuff, and why is Ram wasting his time studying the Chipko movement? So that was one axis of debate around Gandhi. The other was the whole history of the freedom movement, and where for the Marxists, non-violence was again a bourgeois device to wean the classes away from the revolutionary path. And this idea was encoded in a book which was the Bible of the Indian Marxists, R.P. Dutt's book India Today. You know, so I would debate with him. I would say, look, he had to get people together, and you know, maybe there was a reason why he was non-violent. But look at the way he lived. I would tell them, look at the way he lived. He may not have read Das Kapital, but you know, he led an exemplary life with poor working class people. You know, that he embodied in his lifetime the suffering of the peasant under British rule. So those were some of our first debates around Gandhi, and they were sparked by really first by my watching the Chipko activists in the field, and then later reading about Gandhi. So the more serious immersion in Gandhi's writings, Gandhi's life, Gandhi's struggles came much later. But, you know, I remember when I so as it so happened, these are all, you know, accidents of history, that I wrote a letter when I decided to do my research on Chipko. On the same day from Dehradun, I posted an inland letter to Sundar Raj ji in Siliara and to Chandi Prasad ji in Gopeshwar, and saying I want to come and see you, work and talk to you about Chipko. And these were among the few letters I have ever written in Hindi. I mean, this is a confession I'm making to you. मैंने हिंदी में एक खत लिखे क्या और कि मैं आपसे मिलना चाहता हूँ, मैं आऊँगा जब भी आपके पास समय है, मैं आऊँगा. Now Sundar Raj ji was traveling, he didn't get my letter. Chandi Prasad ji replied at once, and I took a bus right up 14-hour bus ride the whole day from Dehradun, changing at Rishikesh up the Alaknanda Valley, and I spent 2 or 3 days with Bhatji. And you know, his, and I said that's true of Sundar Raj ji, it was true of Rara Bhayan band got later, kind of a complete unself-conscious austerity, you know, living a very simple life, very egalitarian dealing with your colleagues. I mean, if you go to the Dasoli Gram Swaraj Mandal office, it's not a office, sarkari hierarchy, you know. My father was a government officer where there's a hierarchy. There's a chaprasi, then there's a peon, then there's a research assistant, and then there's a director, right? So that deeply impressed me. And I went back and told my Marxist teachers, you know, these guys are really living the life. They're enacting socialism in practice, you know, not spouting it in theory. So I think in many ways, meeting Chandi Prasad ji particularly, because he's the person I met first, it's possible that if Sundar Lal ji had got my letter and had met him first, I would have been equally impressed. I mean, people who meet Sundar Lal ji have the same kind of experience. Radha Ben is absolutely astonishing. You know, in 2019, before the pandemic, I spent a week in Kumaon, and 2 days were spent talking to her in her Lakshmi Ashram, you know, and she's already in her mid-80s, right? And, you know, so you get the sense of what it means, a spirit of service, a spirit of commitment, but no arrogance, no ghamand, also a sense of joy, a sense of humor, you know. So you, in a, many ways, these people, they may be the last generation to actually have that, you know, not be judgmental activists, not take themselves too seriously, not be hectoring, but doing their work peacefully, steadily, with commitment, but without preaching, you know, it's their calling. So I think that's really, so my historical understanding of Gandhi comes after my personal experience of Gandhians in the field. I mean, that's how I would put it.
Wonderful. So now let's go to the actual biographical Gandhi, because I think what you've touched upon is the, I like to think of it as the civilizational legacy of Gandhi. And I want to request you to relive that moment at Pietermaritzburg.
Yeah.
Because when Gandhi is thrown off the train in the middle of the night, literally in, pretty much in the middle of nowhere, on a dark railway platform, it had all the makings of a permanent trauma for a young man. Okay, it could have been a justification for him getting trapped in a sense of permanent victimhood. He is humiliated, he's physically pushed off the train, etc. What is it, Ram? What was there in the background that this very ordinary man, up till that point, very ordinary seeming man, rejected? And you know that passage in the biography. He talks about all the obvious feelings came to him. And then he sort of seems to suddenly turn around and say, no, this is not about victimhood. So what is the basis of that? I want you to just share your insights.
I think though Pietermaritzburg is very important in Gandhi's life, both because of his recounting of it in his autobiography, and because Attenborough made it so central to Gandhi's transformation in his film. And I don't want to discount that was a germinal moment, a transformative moment. But there were things that happened before and after that are equally important in understanding Gandhi.
That's precisely what I want you to dwell on.
Yeah. So first, you look at what happened before. Hmm. I think his life in London is underappreciated because we have to look at beyond what he says in his autobiography. Every autobiography, even the autobiography of someone as truthful as Gandhi, is selective. It's the memories you retain. Every autobiography is limited then it can't give the wider social and historical context of the person's time. Now, in London, Gandhi made his first European friends. I think that is very, very important. You know, in Rajkot, he was with basically Gujarati Baniyas. He had one Muslim friend, he talks about Sheikh Mehtab. He had a Parsi headmaster. But to be befriended by Europeans, both collectively and personally, collectively as in the vegetarian society, which gave him a home, which gave him a cause, which gave him a platform to express his views. I mean, it's quite remarkable that the first essays of what were to comprise 90 volumes of Gandhi's collected works were his articles in the Journal of the Vegetarian Society of London. And also friends. I mean, one of Gandhi's early friends, quite unusual man, was Josiah Oldfield, who was a doctor in the Vegetarian Society and with whom Gandhi came to share a home. Now, just think, in the late 1880s, at the center of the empire, a white man and a brown man sharing a home. I mean, this is incredibly transgressive. So in London, Gandhi learnt to distinguish between racism and human beings, between imperialism as a system of exploitation and a white Briton who was as human as him, as capable of suffering, redemption, humanity, goodness, whatever else. So I think that is very important, probably, in understanding why Gandhi's mind was so open. You know, one incident did not embitter him for life, did not turn him against, you know, all forms of every white man, right? Now, I think that's, and the other, what comes later is slightly different. And it's an incident in Gandhi's life, which is by no means well known as the Peter Maritzburg incident, but I think it's equally significant in a commentary on his courage and his character. This happened in January 1896. This is about 2.5 years after Peter Maritzburg. And I should give you the background to this, particularly for your listeners, because it's, as I said, in my view, it's a very important incident in Gandhi's life, somewhat underwritten about. Now, Gandhi goes to South Africa, has this experience on the train, comes back to Durban, and there's a new law passed which obliges him to stay on to fight for the Indians and not come back. So he stays 2 years, and then in 1895 summer, he returns to India to collect his wife and children. He has two children by now. And he goes to collect them, you know, because they come and join him because he's decided to make a life in South Africa. While he's away in India, he publishes a pamphlet called the Green Pamphlet about racial discrimination in South Africa. And the whites of Natal are enraged. And when they hear Gandhi is coming back, they think he's coming with shiploads of Indians to flood their continent with colored people and take away their... Absolutely venomous hatred against Gandhi expressed in the Natal press. And for days, white men, including working class men, are waiting on port side to lynch him. And then, of course, finally he lands and the bulk of the crowd is gone. But a few stragglers remain, identify him, beat him, may have killed him, till again he is saved by a white woman, Mrs. Alexander, wife of the police superintendent. Right. So I think this is, so both the confronting of collective racism. In the case of Peter Maritzburg, the train, it was the racism of one man, the ticket inspector. Here it is the entire white mob of Durban which wants to lynch him. And while he's confronting it, he's saved by a white woman. Right. So I think in the sense of understanding Gandhi, and I think non-violence also comes from this. Non-violence comes from the moral belief that your opponent is capable of redemption, capable of seeing reason, capable of having his or her heart softened, of seeing your point of view. Because if you think you're absolutely right and your opponent is totally wrong, you will shoot him because he doesn't deserve to live. So I think this is his early experiences are also part of the reason he always preferred dialogue and non-violence to armed struggle. And I think that these are, of course, that, and I think you and I are agreed on this, that that's what makes him such a morally superior human being. I mean, to those who practice violence as a means of redressal or getting justice. I mean, yeah. Non-violence is, Gandhi showed, non-violence is always more moral and often more efficacious, often more likely to achieve lasting results as well. But it's these early experiences in London, in Pietermaritzburg, and on the port side at Durban, where he's lynched, almost lynched by a white mob, that I think shaped him.
Of course, the reason I ask this is because the syndrome of victimhood lies at the heart, I think, of what we are today facing and many are calling the crisis of the Republic, right? Because, yes. In fact, very soon, one of the Ahimsa conversations that will be published is with Bhavar Meghwanshi, who talks about his teenage years in the RSS. And so his answer to the question about childhood knowledge of nonviolence, he says, well, I was taught that nonviolence is cowardice, because that's the first references he heard, which was in the Shaka. And it goes back almost 2000 years. And that sense of victimhood is even connected to Emperor Ashok. And the fact that Ashok, after Kalinga, opted for nonviolence is taught as being the reason why Indian society could be enslaved. So would you want to comment on this whole syndrome, which is basically that how and why does historically, because it is a running thread through history, that nonviolence is equated by some people with cowardice?
I think it's a very masculine, macho point of view. Firstly, you know, you want to show your power by beating up on someone, right? I think it's also a very short-sighted point of view. I mean, sustainable change requires institutional change. It requires new laws, new institutions, new practices, and all this can only be achieved through nonviolence. I mean, another great, though he may have used the term ahimsa, in his belief and his practice, another great proponent of nonviolence was B.R. Ambedkar. You know, he was really a constitutional democrat. He was not a revolutionary in the Marxist sense. And much later in life, of course, he came to Buddha. But even before he came to Buddha, he believed in reason, dialogue, transformation through persuasion, organization, yes. You know, and he actually famously led a nonviolent struggle for access to the tank in Mahad. Right. And I think, but with Gandhi, there is another dimension, which goes back to what I said, which is systems of oppression are bad, but those who man those systems of oppression are not necessarily evil. And I want to tell a story about victimhood, if I may, which is part of Gandhi's life and not so well known. Now, Rajni, you live in Mumbai. Now, a great freedom fighter from Mumbai was the socialist Yusuf Mehr Ali, who coined the term Quit India, right? And he was a pioneer of the socialist movement. And this is a lovely story of Yusuf Mehr Ali. In his last days, he was stricken with cancer. There was no cancer treatment in India at that time, in 1946. So his friends arranged for him to go to the Sloan Kettering Hospital in New York. And an American friend of his, the writer Bertram Wolfe, comes to visit him. And later in an obituary, Bertram Wolfe writes, he says, I had known Yusuf Mehr Ali to suffer harsh imprisonment against the British. He was very critical of British imperial rule. But now in 1946, he was saying very nice things about the British. You know, we have got rid of British imperialism, but there may be still some good things about the British that we can keep. Now, I think this is part of Gandhi's moral, mental, philosophical makeup, which those who believe in black and white, Manichaean point, you know, worldviews, you know, good and evil, with me, against me, like the RSS or the Marxists. I mean, there's some very interesting similarities between the RSS and Leninists in this regard. You know, it's like really a very black and white view of the world and of human beings. I think Gandhi saw beyond that, and I think that's part of his greatness. Mm.
Then how would you locate, in this larger frame, how would you locate Bhagat Singh and Bose?
So I think that's very interesting.
And then you can also give us your views on the big question that is never really settled. How central really was nonviolence to the freedom struggle?
Yeah. Or is so, it? Yeah. So I, Absolutely, absolutely. So first members, I think one has to take them, first of all, whoever else Bhagat Singh and Bose belong to, it's not the Sangh Parivar. Both Bhagat Singh and Bose committed to Hindu-Muslim harmony. They believed in secularism and the equality of all religions. That's what drew them close to Gandhi. On the other hand, Bhagat Singh was a Marxist revolutionary. But in the early 20s, you know, Bhagat Singh was, I think, 23 when he died. And when he died in 1930-31, we didn't really know the horrors of the Russian Revolution. It's very likely that if Bhagat Singh had lived another 20 years, like many great thinkers, he would have recognized that utopia or to justice, that one party rule leads to the centralization of power and the demonization of your victims. He may not have become a Gandhian, but I'm sure if Bhagat Singh had lived another 10 or 15 years and come to know the truth about the horrible things that happened under Stalin's rule in the Soviet Union, he would have not remained there. That's a Bhagat Singh. Now, Bose and Gandhi had some genuine philosophical differences. Bose was not committed to nonviolence and had never been. As early as the late 1920s, he's telling Gandhi that we need a more militant, aggressive approach to British colonial rule. Like Gandhi, Bose was absolutely committed to Hindu-Muslim harmony. But on the question of nonviolence, they differed, and also on whom to support in the war. You know, I think Gandhi and Nehru recognized that however vicious and rapacious the British were in India, ruled by the Germans or the Japanese, far worse. The record of the Japanese in China or the Germans in Eastern Europe had shown that compared to them, the British were certainly much better or much less awful. Whereas Bose was willing to ally with Hitler, which I think was a tragic error of judgment. But what's interesting is that Bose continued to admire Gandhi. I mean, in 1943, when Bose was with the Indian National Army and he gave a talk on Azad Hind Radio on 2nd October 1943, Gandhiji's birthday, that's the first known occasion on which anyone called Gandhi father of the nation, and that's Bose. He's addressing Gandhi, who's in jail. Gandhi is in Aga Khan Palace in Pune as a result of the Quit India movement. Here is Bose in Southeast Asia speaking on Azad Hind Radio saying, father of the nation, on your birthday, we rededicate ourselves to the fight for freedom, which you began 20 years ago. And I may have taken different till the father of the nation. That's the truth about, you know, Bose and Bhagat Singh, Bose and Gandhi, which you don't really hear on WhatsApp University. So they had a complex relationship marked by great affection, marked by shared values when it came to Hindu-Muslim harmony, and also equality for women. You know, both Bose and Gandhi brought women into public life, into leadership roles, which is not something the Hindu right is really very, very good at doing. So I think it's a very much more complicated relationship than you think. Now, what bought us freedom? Of course, it was both violence and non-violence. Partly the British were unnerved by the Indian National Army and the naval mutiny in 1946. There's an endless debate on what brought us political freedom from the British. You know, was it decades of intermittent violent protest, starting with the revolution of the late 19th century, coming to Sri Aurobindo, and then of course Bhagat Singh and Bose and the Indian National Army? Was it that? Was it the threat of violent protest and the regular occurrence of violent protest, or was it Satyagraha conducted by Gandhi through his great mass campaigns of the 20s, 30s and 40s? Now that, I think both contributed to the British leaving. But the great contribution Gandhi made was to make us socially and morally prepared for freedom. Because Gandhi recognized that merely political freedom, merely the British leaving our shores, would be nothing if Brahmins continued to oppress Dalits, men continued to oppress women, if Hindus and Muslims were at each other's throat continuously. So, you know, promoting a culture of pluralism, tolerance, interfaith harmony, fighting for gender and caste justice.
In other words,
and economic self-reliance.
what you're saying is essentially non-violence in everyday life.
In everyday, absolutely.
Everyday relationships.
Precisely. Yeah, precisely. Non-violence, understanding, reciprocity in everyday relationships. You know, I think that's what Gandhi gave us over 30 years. And that's, otherwise, we may have become like African countries or Southeast Asian countries who got freedom through armed struggle. We would have become a one-party, totalitarian, patriarchal dictatorship. And I think that's, in that sense, Gandhi recognized that even if freedom takes 30 years to come, if it prepares us socially, ethically, institutionally, it'll be worth it.
Ram, how do you respond to the statement that the 20th century was the most violent ever?
So, in terms of human deaths, yes. And I think largely because military technology had so transformed itself. You know, the two world wars, the wars in Korea, Vietnam, the civil wars in Africa and Latin America, probably account for probably two-thirds of those deaths. Then you, of course, have mass famine in China, Russia, incarceration, persecution, and so on, right? So,
and the atom bomb. And the invention of nuclear weapons.
And the invention of, though, of course, nuclear weapons were used only once, but other kinds of weaponry was equally, destructive.
Yeah.
But, you know, the problem is, in my view, history does not either move upwards or downwards. It goes in a jagged line, right? So something certainly improved in the 20th century. The rights of women, you know, there was hidden violence against women in every society in the world. You know, violence in the family, psychological violence, suppression, various kinds of prohibitions on women. You can't befriend so and so, you can't fall in love, you can't take this job, you can't go to school. So the hidden violence against women, the hidden violence against Dalits, against African Americans, against slaves, right? So how do you quantify violence? Death is not the only form of violence. I mean, if you're born in a woman in an untouchable home and your entire life is of humiliation and drudgery and suffering, you may live 100 years, you know, but in the 15th century, there was no possibility of redemption. In the 20th century, you can move out of the village, go to a town, you can educate yourself, you can vote and choose your leader. So, I think these are complicated questions. And I'm skeptical both of the 20th century was the era of progress and civilization. And that's one point of view. And the other point of view, which is, you know, points to these numbers of those killed as somehow confirming that the 20th century was worse than the 19th century. I don't think it was on balance. I think it's a more complicated issue. And we have to retain what we gained in the 20th century, which is democracy, gender equality, freedom of expression, none of which ever existed before in any society right, across the world, you know, with ways of living peaceably and harmoniously. And I think Gandhi could be a good guide for that.
Absolutely. And there is, of course, you know, this sort of ironic paradox that Gandhi is a contemporary of Hitler, Stalin, and Mao. Well, okay, Mao really enters the stage a bit after Gandhi, but you know, he's a young man at that time. And and how do you then, in that context, look at this again? A very commonly made statement that, oh, Gandhi could only succeed against the British. Non-violence would have never worked against the Nazis.
I think there's some truth to that. I think there is some truth to that for sure. You know, I think it is true. We're not even sure whether non-violence would have succeeded against the French. If you look at the ANC and the South African state, the ANC was inspired by Gandhi from the time it was set up in 1912 till 1960, when it formally abandoned non-violence as its credo. Now, what was interesting about the ANC is that even when they adopted violence, it was selective violence against state targets. It was not kind of indiscriminate violence, killing every white in South Africa. You know, it was not that. But they realized that the South African state had to be shaken up and Satyagraha would not shake it up, you know. So I think there is some truth to the fact that more open societies, less brutal regimes are places in which non-violence may succeed. You know, the Dalai Lama and the Tibetans, I mean, I consider the Dalai Lama the greatest living human being. I mean, that's my personal view. It's my personal view. You know, I've had the great privilege of meeting him twice, of studying his work, but I still recognize that his political strategy has completely failed against the Chinese, right? So I think there is some truth to that view. I think I would not discount it.
And the story of nonviolence after Gandhi, how do you see
that? Well, I think the story of nonviolence after Gandhi is essentially tells you that in quasi-democratic societies, nonviolence can bring about profound social change. The greatest example, of course, is the civil rights movement in America. But if you look at the environmental movement in our country, if you look at some of the movements in Eastern Europe, you know, say Poland was an authoritarian state, but by no means as brutal as Stalin's Russia or Mao's China. And solidarity, on whom Gandhi had an influence. I mean, it's not recognized that adequately recognized that, including Lex Walesa, was inspired by Gandhi. In fact, in Rakesh Sharma's recent film, there is a cameo of Walesa talking about Gandhi. So I think in democratic or quasi-authoritarian societies, not Hitlerian or Stalinist or Maoist societies, where state power will crush you if you just raise your head, right? So I think, and you know, it does not have to bring about political change. It can bring about better race relations, a more harmonious relationship to the environment, equality for women. I mean, I think if you look at, say, the Dravidian movement in India, the movement against Hindi imposition in the South was largely non-violent, and it succeeded. You know, it's and also regional cultural autonomy. I think the farmers' movement today, I think, is an example of how, I mean, I think a farmers movement today, a very interesting contrast would be with the Khalistani movement, which is of Sikh peasants who adopted violence and which led to decades of bloodshed and strife in the Punjab countryside. Whereas today, here are these farmers on the Delhi border, absolutely non-violent, fearless, joyous, singing and making their case so beautifully and effectively. So I think this is an interesting, a future scholar, a young scholar, should write a dissertation comparing the Khalistan movement and what's happening, you know, around the Delhi border today with the Punjab peasants and you know.
And earlier, the anti-CAA protests.
Of course.
Which you yourself got arrested, I think, for half a day.
That's right. Yeah, absolutely. You know, of course, the farmers' protests are of a much larger order.
Yes.
But the anti-CAA protests were totally in the spirit of Gandhi. And for me personally, one of the very nice things about the anti-CAA protests was that in places like Delhi and Bangalore, many of the young students held up posters of Ambedkar and Gandhi together. You know, they were brought together posthumously in a kind of reconciliation, which I found very moving, because we had fraternity to learn from Ambedkar and Hindu-Muslim harmony to learn from Gandhi, and we could draw on them both in our struggle for a more democratic India today. So yes, I mean, the anti-CAA protests, the farmers' struggle are examples of absolutely non-violent protests which have truth and justice on their side.
Bilkul. You know, one other dimension, Ram, is that with the rise of Jean Sharp's work, which really kind of, you know, created a very systematic methodology for nonviolent protests, this question arises, because he insisted that this trying to persuade your opponent, or, you know, hoping for a moral transformation of your opponent is not required. He basically removes the definitely the spiritual and transformative element out.
Yes.
From both Gandhi and Kingian nonviolence. Now, some of the people who have been in this series are saying, no, it's not a conflict, that they see a kind of seamless continuity from the Gandhi-Kingian worldview to Jean Sharp. What is your view on this?
I think there are certainly some parallels and continuities. I think Sharp himself started as a scholar of Gandhi. His PhD thesis was a study of Gandhian Satyagraha. Satyagraha Gandhi had led. But I think he recognized that even without the moral element, there was a pragmatic element to nonviolence. You know, dharna, satyagraha, pradarshan, congregation, blocking arteries peacefully, you know, and of course now with social media, spreading the word. So, you know, I think he, it is, you're right, that he kind of took, he made it more humdrum and mundane and pragmatic. And that's the kind of, to use the infamous phrase, that's the toolkit that he that he drafted, that was used in Eastern Europe and in Burma and in many other places. Right. Now, but there is a continuity. I mean, he got the, I think, of course, and you see, Sharp was a person who recognized he was really a more a program implementer. He was not a conscience of society in the way in which King and Gandhi were. You know, he knew that they had a different order of significance. You know, they embodied. I mean, Gandhi embodied the conscience of a people oppressed by Western imperialism. King embodied the conscience and humanity of a people oppressed by American racism. You know, so they personally embodied something much larger. And, you know, Sharp was a tactician, and I think that's fine.
There's need for that also, is what you're saying.
Of course, and he played a very important role. And I think I would love to read a good biography of Sharp. I mean, he died 2 or 3 years ago, and you know, his journey to India, what he did in America, how his writings influenced people across the world, how they were translated in so many languages.
Yeah.
You know, it would be very interesting to read a good biography of Sharp.
At the same time, since we live in a world that where societies and almost everyday life seems to be so bitterly polarized, isn't there something very, very vital in both the Gandhian and the Kingian view that I cannot be liberated until my opponent is also liberated? You know, when King is saying this over and over again, I will never be liberated till the white man is liberated from his and her hatred of the colored person. Gandhi is saying this about the British. So, in that sense, what is the promise of the Gandhian, Kingian approach going forward?
I think Gandhi is saying that about upper caste Hindus too, who discriminate against lower caste.
That's right.
He's saying that about them too, right? So absolutely. I mean, I think that is the moral power and the moral grandeur of the King Gandhi worldview, you know. And in a sense, Mandela is also saying it later on, you know. I think, and successfully, I think one of the most admirable things about the South African transition was while the transition was taking place, was being completed, Mandela was president. And de Klerk was deputy president under him. The last president of the apartheid state was serving under a black man. Now, only Mandela could have brought that about. You know, it's not some of the revolutionaries in the ANC who had a black and white view of the world could not. So I think, yes, absolutely. I mean, I think that certainly appeals to me a great deal. And I think this, I personally find that you may call it spiritual element, ethical element, whatever you may want to call it, that added ethical element in their politics, I think, makes it transcendental and makes it, in a sense, universal, which I think is really the most important contribution.
How is the immediate future looking to you? If we look at nonviolence in two dimensions, we know now over the last 70 years, many nonviolent protest movements against an oppressive state have been successful. Okay, there are studies on this. We also know that there is a great deal of nonviolent mobilization against the structural violence of the economic system and the environmental and social displacement and disruption that it is causing. But in a broad sense, what is your hopefulness? Or I know you're never a pessimist, but what is your realistic assessment of, say, the next 20 years, in which will really make or break whether we can make it through the rest of this century. environmentally.
Well, you see, it's impossible to predict what will happen.
No, but I'm asking for a prediction. I'm asking for...
But I think...
Go ahead.
I'd say the anti-CA protests and the farmers' protests, I think, have revived the idea of collective, principled, non-violent protest. An affirmation of elementary human values, of decency, humanity, justice, you know, in a non-violent way, against an unfeeling and communalized state. I think not just unfeeling, but communalized. In fact, even in the farmers' protests, there's been some communal rhetoric against Sikhs that has been used by the supporters of the government. You know, it's not only against the women of Shaheen Bagh, the admirable women of Shaheen Bagh who were stigmatized because of their faith. Also, sometimes the male farmers on the borders. So I think that's something, you need a state that listens, that responds, that is capable of being humanized. But I think, the other aspect which I've been hopeful of is the resistance from the states, Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, even to some extent Maharashtra, against a steamrolling, homogenizing Hindi Hindutva point of view, you know, which is kind of promoted. One nation, one leader, one NGO, which is the RSS, one ideology, etc., etc., right? So we are a land of many diversities and we should glory in it, right? And that's certainly part of what Gandhi's message to us. So I think it's a difficult time for us. I think particularly with the pandemic, economic inequalities have grown enormously. I mean, the number of billionaires has grown, but the number of jobless people has grown exponentially much more. I think this is it's a turning point in our history. I've been saying this for more than a year, that this is our greatest crisis since partition. And the difference is, when we were confronted with partition, we had Nehru and Patel and Ambedkar and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay to help guide us through that crisis. And now we don't have remotely that caliber of leaders. So civil society perhaps has to, you know, pull its weight, and so do all of us. But, you know, the thing I'd say about Gandhi, this is something which Gopal Krishna Gandhi, who's not merely Gandhi's grandson, but a great student and scholar of Gandhi's thought, once told me. He said, and Gandhi belongs to the world, not to us. And even if we expel him, he'll be affirmed and upheld elsewhere, just as the Buddha was. We expelled the Buddha and the rest of the world found him. And I think, you know, you mentioned Gene Sharp in our conversation. We've talked about Gene Sharp, Lech Walesa, Nelson Mandela, Dalai Lama, Martin Luther King. And I think that's Latin American Gandhis, Italian Gandhis, Chinese Gandhis. There's an interest in Gandhi in China. I mean, you'd be surprised. The Chinese actually admire Gandhi because they recognize how oppressive their state is. And they have a sneaking interest in Gandhi. Young Chinese people want to know about Gandhi. So I think that's... The Indians may reject him just as we rejected the Buddha. But other cultures, other countries, other civilizations, I think, will take him up.
And the structural violence, for example, how do you see the Fridays for Future? Because in a sense, struggle.
No, I think I am not, I must confess, I've not studied very carefully. But my view is of the environmental predicament is, I think, it's colored a lot by my early experiences. A global perspective, which is, you know, climate change, is important. But the kind of grassroots perspective of building sustainable societies bottom up, which was what Chipko and Narmada were about, I think we are in danger of losing that. You know, we are sacrificing something in making environmentalism a transnational global movement. The grassroots connectivity that I think the environmental movement of the 70s and 80s had, not just in protest movements, but in reconstruction work, you know, in experiments in Maharashtra, in reviving village tanks, community irrigation systems, all of that. I think that's something which I think needs to be invigorated afresh. Bottom-up environmentalism.
But isn't it also because, I mean, many people who did that, who were part of that bottom-up environmentalism, are now realizing that no matter how much good work they do, it is being undone by the macro-structural violence. And so how do you change? In a sense, today's imperialism is that structural violence of the macro system which in spite of you know, all the alarm bells ringing on climate change, actually is not moving to do the needful.
I think it has to happen simultaneously. I mean, Gandhi, that's what Gandhi would do. You know, I don't think he would neglect. I think the problem with bottom-up environmentalism is that the people who pioneered it and gave their lives for it are now in their 70s and 80s. And a younger generation hasn't come to take their place. It's not that they realize it's futile, you know, but all the remarkable environmentalists we grew up admiring, you know, Radha Bhatt, Medha Patkar, you know, Chandi Prasad Bhatt, they're all in their 70s and 80s. And there are no younger replacements for them. I mean, why? That's a different question somebody must answer. But, you know, surely in, say, my home state, Karnataka, a great deal can be done on reviving irrigation tanks. You know, we sustain agriculture in a much more, you know, long-term way than, you know, tube wells that depend on electricity and so on, right? So, but that kind of energy that was once there, somehow, you know, there may be many reasons. I think there's been a fragmentation of society because of social media, you know, that everyone with their smartphone rather than out together in a meeting or a dharna or whatever, right? So I think I would not posit it as an either or, you know, that's a Marxist point of view. The Marxist point of view is first reform the system. The Gandhian point of view is reform yourself as well as the system.
Correct. I think I see many of the young people who are working as whatever name you want to give it, whether you call it Fridays for Future, they are not famous in the way that the earlier movements were.
Yeah.
But their work is, I think, simultaneously trying to do this. Address the immediate, address the micro, and all that is meaning transform how you live. But also to fight for the, you know, the structural changes which are needed to save life as we know it pretty much.
Absolutely.
So in closing, Ram, what advice would you give, or what observations would you share with young people who are drawn to nonviolence, but sometimes feel daunted that it looks very difficult?
You know, Rajni, the older I've got, the more hesitant I am to give advice. Okay, so just be open-minded, be curious, read particularly things from the other point of view. You know, try and read the most persuasive arguments against climate change if you can find them. For a Hindu majoritarian state, if you can find them. You know, one of the problems in social media is that we are in our silos. We are only with our own herd, you know, people who think like us. Travel. You know, experience different parts of India. I think travel to different parts of India is an enormously eye-opening experience. I mean, I think personally very fortunate in that I'm a South Indian who grew up in North India and studied in Calcutta and then traveled around. So that's the only kind of general advice I give, you know, people. I mean, I think everyone must find their own path, their own way. You know, good luck to you in whatever you do.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks, Ajit. Thank you.